would be starting the first session of the third day of this Science and Jain Philosophy Conference. Just now we are going to have round table. The topic is developing scientific calm spiritual technique for inculcation of moral values and development of EQ in global education. A very important topic, and we are going to focus on moral values and in the context of global education. In the chair, Dr. Naresh Chandra, Birla College, Mumbai, India. I welcome Dr. Chandra.
Good morning, and we are beginning with this round table. Maybe I will share some of my feelings a little later. I am told that Dr. S. C. Manchanda has to go urgently, and may I request him to be the first speaker and express his words. The session, I'm sure, will be very interesting. We will all enjoy, and some outcome will definitely be there of the session. Professor Manchanda has been the head of the department earlier of Department of Cardiology at AIIMS, New Delhi. So may I request Professor Manchanda, please.
Thank you for allowing me to give some of my comments. These are just small comments that I would make in this round table. I am a cardiologist, I am a doctor, but I have been interested in combining science and spirituality for the benefit of heart health especially. We have done several studies with Preksha meditation and shown that it is extremely useful, and this is now internationally accepted. Our articles are quoted all over the world. I believe that the solution of problems of mankind of today are combining science with spirituality. All the top scientists have always said that spirituality without science may not be acceptable, and science without spirituality is also lame. We did an experiment long back in which we showed that if we combine Preksha meditation with the usual techniques that we do in cardiac patients, we are able to prevent progression of the disease, even reverse the disease, and we have saved thousands of people. Now the topic here is scientific and spiritual techniques for inculcating moral values and all. I would like to say that when we talk of spirituality, it means different things to different people. I think moral values are a very important part of that. Spirituality to me means that it tells me who am I. I'm not an expert like all of you are. I'm already a cardiologist and all. I am not the body. I'm controlled by something called mind. I have intellect and I have consciousness. This is what a whole human being is. So, to me, understanding of spirituality is who am I? I am really the consciousness or the spirit which has a body around it. The moment we, I think, assume that, there are lots of problems which are solved, especially in my patients and all that. The moment a person gets a heart attack, he tells me, I'm going to die. I said, you cannot die. It is the consciousness. You are the consciousness, the body. You should not consider yourself body, because body is changing every time. From the childhood to the adulthood, you see the body being destroyed. You were a child. Child has died. Youth has died. And body is changing every year. Every cell of the 95% of the cells really change within a year or so. So I think the spirituality in young people is very, very important. We have been doing spirituality courses through the Preksha meditation in young children. You know that Science of Living is there. I have participated in that. And we have got tremendous results in the children and all. So I think the best way to introduce spirituality through Preksha meditations in the school. There is a lot of evidence that the performance improves, all the bad habits that cause disease ultimately, like stress, smoking, and lack of activity, lack of exercise, etc., all starts in childhood and ultimately causes the disease and all. But it improves the performance. We have done a small experiment in with Swami Dharmananji in some schools in Chhatarpur, a small town near Delhi. And we asked the principal, please give us children who trouble you, who are making noises. Either they are not, parents are not happy there, or they are bully people, they are teasing the other. And we taught them Preksha meditation. In 3 months, these children completely changed. They became the best. And now most of the schools are asking us that, why don't you come and teach Preksha meditation or spirituality? Unfortunately, spirituality has not too much of scientific backing. This is an age of science. So unless I think we bring out the scientific data, it won't be acceptable in the modern age, which is a scientific age and all. But fortunately, there's a huge amount of data available, both from our country and elsewhere, especially United States of America, that we should really teach spirituality in the children, and how do the children perform. The question is of EQ. We know that IQ is possibly not responsible for success. People with the highest IQ are not very, very successful people. It is the EQ, emotional quotient, which is very important. If one can control the emotions, this is true for my heart patients also, the bad emotions like anger, ego, hostility, jealousy, and you have positive emotions like compassion, altruism, love, etc., it really makes you a good human being. And it makes your performance better. After all, what are the children interested in when they are in the schools? They want to have a better performance. They want to do very well in schools. One of my colleagues from Mumbai had done a study long back in medical students, and she showed that first-year medical students, half of them were given Preksha meditation, half were not. And those who were taught Preksha meditation, they topped in the college, and therefore the whole college started doing it. So I think this is a movement, and our Prime Minister, because of his efforts, has made this 21st June as the International Day of Yoga, because it's no more an Indian tradition, because yoga, I think, is one of the best methods of learning spirituality. It is an international now practice, and a lot of people are doing research and all. And many schools throughout the world are accepting that yoga should be there, because the aim of education is not only to produce good students with good IQ. We want them good human beings, and that cannot come unless the emotional and better than emotional spiritual quotient comes in them. So my take or whatever my impression is that it should be made almost mandatory, just like we ask children to do exercise, to learn spirituality at the school age. Not only it will improve their performance, it will make them better students, there will be less of fights, etc., and less of bad habits, which ultimately cause heart attacks, hypertension, and diabetes. Thank you very much.
And I will request Dr. Harsha Thakur from TIS to express his views.
I take this opportunity to thank Dr. Mishra and his team for inviting me for this scientific cum spiritual conference. Again, my background is medical background. I have done MBBS and MD in public health. So I am with Tata Institute of Social Sciences, and I basically teach public health and epidemiology. So I will like to express my views from that perspective. So basically, in health, we study the diseases from two points of view. First is research, and then we try to apply this research for prevention and control of the diseases so that we have better health. And our aim is health for all, not for health for some people. So coming to the diseases, we have basically two types of diseases, communicable and non-communicable. And as most of you are aware, communicable diseases like tuberculosis, malaria, HIV, AIDS, cholera, diarrheal diseases, they are quite prevalent in India still now. And in addition, we have non-communicable diseases fast catching up. So we have diabetes, cardiovascular diseases, and all that. And obviously, both these groups lead to each other. Means the non-communicable diseases will lead down to lower immunity, which can lead to further susceptibility to communicable diseases. Again, in India, we have two types of India. One is rich India, one is poor India. And it is not that only poor India is suffering, but rich India is also suffering. So rich India has got non-communicable diseases, poor India has got both communicable and non-communicable. And obviously, you cannot differentiate between them. Means rich countries, poor countries. So India comes into now middle income countries, but still we are considered as poor country. So there are different problems facing rich countries, different problems facing poor countries, and obviously there is international politics. So we have to be aware of that also. Means we have to see that we serve the interest of India, and not at a miss. Rich countries will of course try to force us to serve their interest, but we have to be aware what is our interest. So that also we have to look into account. And again, within India, we have interstate differences. Again, we have rural areas, tribal areas, urban areas. Again, urban areas are not so much developed as we know. We have got air pollution, water pollution. Again, urban slums are a big problem. So we have huge amount of problems, and the solution, I will say, means from public health point, basically we have four levels of preventions. That is, one is secondary prevention. Secondary prevention means once the disease appears, you try to diagnose it as early as possible and then give the treatment. Then there is a tertiary prevention. That means the disease is now irreversible. So we'll try to limit the disability caused by the disease. And at the same time, if there is disability, we try to rehabilitate that particular person from social point of view, physical point of view. But the most important is primary prevention. Primary prevention is basically we try to see that the disease does not develop itself. So for non-communicable diseases, we have various risk factors like smoking, alcoholism, poor behavioral habits. Again, for communicable diseases, we have various risk factors, our personal hygiene, social hygiene, availability of drinking water, sanitation facilities. And before that, primary prevention, we have primordial prevention. Primordial prevention is basically these various risk factors I have told you, so that you try to see that these risk factors don't appear in our population. So for example, the smoking, alcoholism, or good personal hygiene. So in the childhood itself, you try to inculcate these basic habits, like not going for smoking, not going for alcoholism, trying to avoid junk food, availability of safe drinking water, using toilets, and avoiding open defecation. So that this part will be basically covered by education. So education is quite important for this perspective. And again, as you know, in India, though we are trying to achieve more and more literacy, but it is well known that illiteracy is also quite high. So we have to simultaneously tackle this particular problem. Means you cannot avoid this or improve health by only tackling or trying to improve those who are getting education. So at the same time, we have to see that those who are not having access to education, they get access to education either in their mother tongue or in other languages, so that they are exposed to primordial prevention and primary prevention. Basically, what are our basic needs? Our basic needs are quite simple. Food, water, clothing. So all these are our basic needs. Spirituality will come after that, I will say. That is from medical point of view. So try to provide these basic needs, avoid the poverty, remove the poverty, or I will say eliminate or eradicate the poverty, so that automatically, once your basic needs are satisfied, you achieve good health, obviously, then you can go for spiritual well-being. So as you know, there is a Maslow's need hierarchy. So once you achieve the basic needs, then we'll go for advanced needs of emotional well-being. Again, I will try to quote the definition of health. Health is mentioned, means defined in by World Health Organization as not only physical, social well-being, but also emotional and spiritual well-being. So that is also important component. But for that, we have to be inclusive. Means there is a lot of social exclusion. So that we have to avoid. So there are a lot of people who are totally neglected from these services. We have to bring them into gambit of these services. And here I would like to say a few words about means what are these things. Basically, we have to see that the basic health services are available to all, not only to urban rich people or middle class people. Again, availability is not important, accessibility is important. Means many slum areas, the private hospitals are available, but they cannot go there. Or in rural areas, the services are available, but they cannot go because of the poor infrastructure. So we have to see that there is a good infrastructure in terms of transport, communication facilities. Then there is a third A of affordability. So we have to see that our health services, social welfare services are also affordable. So everyone can afford them. For below poverty line population, we can try to make them subsidized or free services. But at the same time, you have to see that there is no leakage of subsidy, leakage of benefits, and denial of benefits. So these two things we must take into account. Fourth thing is acceptance. We have to see that whatever services we are providing, they are acceptable to the people who are getting those services. So we might be providing them high-tech services, but they might not accept it. So we have to take into account their religious beliefs, other beliefs, social beliefs, and then accordingly provide the services. And finally, accountability. Accountability means quality. So quality of the services has to be maintained. We cannot compromise on the quality. Means that means we cannot provide some basic services to poor people and some high-fi services to rich people. It should be, I will say, equity. We have to achieve equity in terms of that, equality. So everyone should be equal as far as provision of the services are concerned. And here the education plays quite important roles, both scientific education, spiritual education. And again, as I mentioned, we have to take into account high level of illiteracy. Also, we have to take into account high level of school dropouts. So many students, they go for school, they go to school the initial period, but later on they drop out. Also, we have this policy of some states, they do have this policy of allowing students to go to the next year without appearing for exam. So we have to see the merits and demerits of that particular policy, because they will directly go to higher level, but they might not be aware about the basic things. So all these things we have to take into account. Finally, I would like to mention two things. One is social marketing or information, education, and communication. So social marketing, we have commercial marketing. So commercial marketing is for profit of some private companies for their own benefits. But social marketing will be for benefits, not for profit, and for the benefit of the entire community. So for that, we have to see that we provide good information, good education, and good communication, IEC. And finally, everyone knows about sustainable development. That also we have to keep into account when we are talking about scientific and spiritual development and also emotional quotient. So sustainable development, I will just repeat, that is meeting the needs of the present generation without compromising needs of the future generation. So what is happening is that we are just concentrating on our needs or our greeds, I will say. We are not only thinking about needs but also greeds. So we have to see that, yes, our needs are important, basic needs are important, but we are not going to live here for indefinitely. We are also mortal, okay? Nobody is immortal. So there is going to be a future generation and they will also have their needs, but we are exploiting our resources so that our future generation might not be able to achieve their own needs. So that is sustainable development. So we have to meet our needs, but at the same time, we have to see that future generation needs are not compromised. So as Mahatma Gandhi had said, we must think about needs, not about the greeds. Okay, thank you very much.
The next is our colleague, senior colleague, Professor Rupa Shah, is a former vice chancellor of SNDT University and great academic expert. So may I request Rupa Shah Madam to please.
Gurus, Mahagurus, जिनका हमें एडवांटेज लेने को आता नहीं है, ये तो नदियां तो बहती है. How many of us really take a dip? Whether the Ganges cleans up or not is not important. But the river flows. And who made it as messy and dirty as it is today? We did it. गंगा पवित्र है तो उसकी पवित्रता रखनी वो गंगा का काम नहीं है, वो हमारा काम है. सो ये जो लहरें बहती है, ऑल दीज रिवर्स ऑफ अटर अचीवमेंट, एंड आई थिंक जैनिज्म इज वन रिलीजन. आई एम नॉट डेनिग्रेटिंग एनी अदर रिलीजन, प्लीज. I don't want to use this platform or abuse it in any form, but I definitely feel that other religions have their goods also. Otherwise, they wouldn't be prevalent. Some religions have traveled the world over. I think you're all aware that the 500 old temples of Krishna that have been discovered in the southeast part of Asia. So religions have traveled because traveling was a part of that religion. In Jainism, we believed in consecration, we believed in travel up to a point, up to human capacity. We did not go beyond the human capacity. Now, who has taken Jainism beyond India? अपने तो धर्म में पद यात्रा है, सो हम जा नहीं पहुंच पाए. इट इज वी हु हैव कैरीड जैनिज्म ऑन आर बैक्स लाइक अ पालखी एंड टेकन इट. जैन्स हु वेंट एंड स्टेड इन अमेरिका, इन अफ्रीका, इन अमेरिका, इन यूके, दे आर द वंस दैट कैरीड देयर रिलीजन. एंड इट इज डिफिकल्ट टू कैरी अ रिलीजन, particularly Jainism, because the paradigms and the basic philosophical epistemology that is involved in Jainism is that of self-denial, not rejection. This, in my utter humility, is the biggest definition of Jainism, that it is a self-denial. Aap kaun hote ho jo hame nahi denge, hame hi nahi chahiye. So, we never feel deprived. Have you found a religion that processes, that declares, that invites very openly, says that I'm not going to reject you, but you are going to learn how to deny it? कई लोग पूछते हैं, आप लोग उपवास करते हैं, अट्ठाई करो, 3 महीने के 90 दिवस करते हो, उससे भी ज्यादा करने वाले हैं, तो आपको भूख नहीं लगती? डोंट यू फील टेम्प्टेड टू ईट? बट व्हेन यू आर आई एम डिनाइंग दिस, तो देन आई देर इज मेरे अंदर में जरूरत ही नहीं रही इसकी. सो अगर ये बेसिक है अपना, अपने को वो डिसिप्लिन ही अंदर से स्वयंभू करनी है ऑफ डिनायल. और डिनायल में जो पावर है वो लेने में या देने में नहीं है. डिनायल हम अर्पण करते हैं, और जब अर्पण करते हैं तब हाथ यूं होता है, लेते हैं तो यूं होते हैं, देते हैं तो यूं होते हैं. अर्पण में ही ये संस्कार है कि वेयर यू ओपन एंड यू ऑफर, एंड दिस टू मी इज द एसेंस ऑफ जैनिज्म, वेयर वी आर ऑफरिंग आवरसेल्व्स थैंक यू. बहुत सिंपल चीजें हैं. आई डोंट वॉन्ट टू गो इन टू हाई फ्लोन फिलोसफी. जैनिज्म इज फॉर द आम जनता बिकॉज वो धर्म नहीं है. वो रहने का जीने का एक तरीका है. इट्स अ वे ऑफ लाइफ. एंड इफ इट इज अ वे ऑफ लाइफ वी जस्ट हैव टू लिव इट. जैसे हम ब्रीथ करते सांस लेते कितनी स्वाभाविक तरह से सांस लेते इतनी स्वाभाविक तरह से हम जैनिज्म के प्रिंसिपल्स अगर अपना ले ग्रहण करें. अपनाना तो ठीक है. एडॉप्शन इज नॉट ऑलवेज कंप्लीट. बट सांस लेना जितना जरूरी तो है ही है. बट हम स्वाभाविक तरह से लेते हैं. सो इफ वी प्रैक्टिस व्हाट इज रिटन डाउन एज धर्म. असल में कोई लॉ कोर्ट्स नहीं थे कि कुछ भी होना है करना है तो उसका फतवा निकालो बिल करो फिर लॉ करो. ऐसी कोई बात ही नहीं थी. सो काफी चीजें धर्म के नाम पे एक कायदा हो गया लॉ हो गया. इट वॉज अ वे ऑफ फॉलोइंग. देयर वॉज नो लॉ. आर वी वेरी हैवी ऑन द प्रेस हियर? नो देन आई हैव टू बी केयरफुल. The tenets and the tablet that were brought down from the hill to preach a religion in 10 points were all do's and don'ts. Thou shalt not, thou shalt not. Jainism is negative, hai hi nahi. Negative kahan se aaye? Aap dhoondenge kahan se? क्योंकि आप सेल्फ डिनाई करते हो. तो हु कैन से कि डोंट डू दिस और डोंट डू दैट. इट इज ऑल द टाइम डू दिस डू दिस. विच कैन यू सी द अमाउंट एंड डेप्थ ऑफ पॉजिटिविटी इन दिस रिलीजन. इट इज इंटेंस. इट इज एक्सपेंसिव एंड इट इज वेरी वेरी इंडिविजुअलिस्टिक. वी डू नॉट प्रैक्टिस ग्रुपिज्म. Congregational situations are different, but basically our way of life is very, very individualistic. And sometimes, let me assure you, I would wish to admit to this public congregation, I am not a Jain by birth. I'm a Jain by marriage. And I got interested in the religion as a responsibility. My mother-in-law was very active in the Derasar and Agraganya wo karte the activities. And you know, kai baar, I have 9 sisters-in-law. Haan, toplo bhar ke. और वो कोई इतने इंटरेस्टेड नहीं थे मेरे सास के काम में. ठीक है, शी इज डूइंग इट ना. एंड आई ऑलवेज यूज टू से कि जो भी धर्म करते हैं पर्टिकुलरली दिस पर्टिकुलर धर्म वो खुद ही रख सकते हैं. वो डिस्ट्रीब्यूट नहीं कर सकते हैं. सो इफ यू ऑल थिंक दैट शी इज द ओनली वन हु इज डूइंग इट एंड वी विल ऑल यू नो फ्रिंज बेनिफिट्स पेरिफेरल बेनिफिट्स पर्क्स उनके धर्म से हमें मिलेंगे वो नहीं होने वाला है. बट देन आई वॉज द फर्स्ट डॉटर इन लॉ टू कम इन टू द फैमिली. सो आई वॉज जेयर डैड कि पहले नवमी और नववार नमाज पढ़े. सो भाभी अभी थोड़ा पर्सनैलिटी ट्रेट सास के ऊपर इन्फ्लुएंस करना चाहते हैं कि नहीं मैं तो अच्छी बहू हूँ. बट देन वेन आई गॉट माई चिल्ड्रन my mother-in-law used to take them to the temple and they were very excited. Chintus they were. Tya ghoda hoy and they would go there ke derasar ni bahar aaje bada ghoda ne badu ena upar beswa mare. And which I thought, what a wrong reason are my children being attracted to go to a place of worship, to go to a place of peace, to go to a place where one seeks beyond hathi and ghoda. It began that way. But then I also felt that because they started asking me, why does Ba do this? Why doesn't Ba eat with us? Why does she need pani and all For them, thalnu tharelu pani was a big joke. Ke ma comes and, you know, pani ham thandu thase. It was activity for them. And I didn't have answers. And I thought, if I have to be a mother to my children, it is my responsibility to give them their janmajat dharma. So, if janmajat hoy ke na hoy, it is important that wherever we go deep into it, go deep into the philosophy of it. And I think Jainism is one philosophy, one epistemology, which doesn't need to strain you intellectually, socially, EQ, emotionally. There is no strain in understanding this. It is self-evident, self-proving. And in such a situation, where we find the, I mean, a doctor from AIIMS just talked about the cardiac arrests and the BP problems, the allergies, where here, being a psychologist, I know that there are severe diseases caused to allergies, psychological traumas that come in. So medically also, as he said, if from school ye prakar ki yoga practice ho rahi hai, to the presupposition that you don't have to grow and practice religion. Nahin, wo toh bade honge tabhi we'll start going to the Dehrasa. After a certain age, when we've had our fun, then we'll go there. It is something that must be inculcated, that must be developed, like a language. Ek family aayi thi mere paas, bache ne pehla shabd kya kaha? Normally bolte hai maa, dada, ba, kaka. But this child learned to say the word dhua. And I inquired with the mother, I said, dhua is a very funny word. It's not easy for diction, tongue turning. Dhu, for a baby to say dhu. So even the mother didn't know. And then I put some incense where there would be dhua. And the child immediately said, dhua. I said, so the child has learned from some smoke. And I said, does your husband smoke? Do you smoke? So he said, yes, he's a cigar or chirut and hokli peete hai. I said, this is where the sanskar of not ma, dada, kaka, papa, but dhua. Ye bacha dhua sikha. So, kab kahan se sanskar aa jate hain? We don't know. So if we can start the practice of good things from a very, very young age, kam se kam dhua to nahi aayega. So friends, the other aspect that I want to emphasize here, particularly since this session is on techniques for inculcation of moral values and development of EQ and global education, and that is, it's a model full of humility. It's not very practical, but someday, maybe someone is going to take it up. I'm trying to work at it for certain schools in Ahmedabad, where from the 8th standard to 10th standard, that's 8th, 9th, and 10th, they will be taught the religion they were born into for not just 50 marks ka paper. And they will have another 50 marks of any other religion that the child or the parent likes. Ki koi bhi Sikhism hai, Isu hai, Buddhism hai, anything plus the 50 mark mothership religion that. And the child grows from 8th, 9th and 10th. 8th, 9th and 10th, the mother religion will remain constant, so he's done at the end of it. 150 marks of the mother religion, 50-50 mark leke, or 50-50 mark, the child can change the religion.